Hey, I'm James Cook, bass player for Luke Bryan, and you're watching For Bass Players Only. Whoa, whoa, whoa,
whoa. Hi everyone, John Liebman here. You're watching For BassPlayersOnly.com. We're coming to you today on location from Ford Field in Detroit, home of the Detroit Lions. Hopefully you'll put some positive vibes in the arena tonight for the Lions. But we're here tonight for the Luke Bryan concert. And sitting next to me here is our special guest, Luke Bryan bassist, James Cook. Hey, James.
Hey, John. Good to be here.
It's great to be here with you. And we're looking forward to the show tonight.
It's going to be a good one.
It always is. Yeah. Want to talk about you and bass and things like that. I was reading up on you. You're originally from Louisiana.
I am.
And if I read correctly, you were actually a saxophone major in college. Is that right?
That is correct. I majored in saxophone and played all the woodwinds. I actually did a lot of repair work. So I had a shop where I did all the repairs for all the woodwinds and brass and everything like that. So, yeah, I mean, it's crazy going from saxophone to playing bass guitar. Yeah. You know,
how'd you come down to the dark side with us bottom feeders?
Well, when I was a kid, I always played a little bit of guitar. My father was a guitar player, just kind of an amateur guitar player. So I picked it up and started actually playing bass at church, the Baptist church, Southern Baptist church. They needed a bass player, so they had a bass. So I picked it up, and I kind of felt like I had a lot more command of the bass. And I had a honky-tonk piano player that was great. She had a great left hand. And she really coached me into the whole honky-tonk gospel type of walking bass lines and stuff like that. And I took to it pretty well, and I just fell in love with it.
And you said, hey, James is here. Why don't you give that left hand a rest and let me do what I do? Well, about how old were you? Was this before college, before saxophone and woodwinds, or when did the bass come into your life?
Well, the bass came into my life, yeah. I was in high school, actually. Okay. So I started out clarinet in band and then moved on to saxophone and then started playing the bass probably around 15, 16 years old. And
that's when I started.
Yeah. Never put it down. And I never put down the guitar. I play a lot of guitar as well. A lot of what I do now is I have a studio. I do a lot of production, so I'm always playing a lot of guitar work, a lot of I do a lot of horn stuff too. So as a bass player, you know, like we love Jaco and – you know, and Rocco Prestia from Tower of Power, and I had a horn band. We played all that funk soul stuff, and so I get to do a lot of horn line stuff for people that don't normally do that. So they kind of come to me and go, hey, man, we need some horns, you know. So
how about the Brecker Brothers? Were they on your radar?
Yeah, we listened to the Brecker Brothers, yeah. It's really, really good stuff.
What about bass influences, bass heroes? Who was on your radar?
Well, you know, you have the normal
other than Jaco and Rocco.
Yeah, the normal Jaco and Rocco, and yeah. You know, of course, I love Victor Wooten. He's turned out to be a friend of mine, which is pretty amazing.
I just ran into him the other day in Boston, as a matter of fact.
Good guy, very good guy. He's helped me out a lot in Nashville. I was a very big fan of some of the blues guys, some of the people that you don't know their names. One guy that really was a big influence on me was Tommy Shannon. He played with Stevie Ray Vaughan, of course, in Double Trouble.
We have an interview with him on ForBassPlayersOnly.com.
Oh, nice. Well, tell him that I'm a big fan of his. Okay. He has a big influence. Now, seriously, so, you know, I was the guy that looked at records and LPs back in the day when they sold them, you know, and I want to know who's playing on them. So, yeah.
Me too.
So a lot of my favorite players were the guys that you've never heard of. You know, of course, like Carol Kay and James Jamerson. I mean, obviously, I can sit and listen to the isolated bass tracks of Jamerson and just sit there and giggle because it's so good. You know what I'm talking about?
About probably a mile from where we're sitting right now is where all that history was made.
It's amazing. I'd love to soak up some of that.
Yeah, Carol Kay, by the way, I interviewed also, and she gave me a whole lot of time and a whole lot of information. Wonderful interview with Carol Kay.
A buddy of mine that's been taking some lessons from Carol and getting some online stuff, and I'm like, that sounds pretty good. I think I might do that too.
Yeah, God bless her. She's 82, 83 years old,
still
something like that.
It.
Yeah, yeah. Well, what about your career? How did that get rolling? Did you do much career-wise as a saxophone player, or was that pretty much the bass where you were, you know, playing music for money?
Yeah, saxophone, you know, I played in our jazz band in college where I went. played a little bit in this funk horn band, but I always wanted to gravitate towards the bass. I was waiting for the bass chair to open up. And when the bass chair opened up, I pretty much just kind of stuck to playing bass and guitar. As far as the saxophone goes, like I said, I did a lot of more recording work and arranging stuff, but kind of stuck to the bass. And starting out, I think what really got me going was my push to Nashville. I wanted to move to Nashville when I was a young kid, and I would listen to, strangely enough, a lot of country radio going and sitting in the car with my family, and I just, for some reason, was gravitated, was really wanting to go and record. I just wanted to be a recording guy. But moving on, as I got a little older, I started listening to like Jocko and Rocco and Tower Power, and I got to more into the funk soul, a lot of James Brown stuff, Bootsy and all that. But make a long story short, moved to Nashville in 2001, and I came off of a gig that was that funk soul, really, really big horn band gig. Moved to Nashville and immediately started immersing myself into country music. I learned each and every song that I could pick up, and any artist, Merle Haggard, George Jones, all the traditional guys. And pretty shortly, about a year after moving to Nashville, I got the gig. When I say the gig means you got an artist gig on a label. So that's like being legit. That's what everybody wants. They want to get an artist gig, meaning you go out and you go on a tour bus and you're actually playing places all over the country. So my first real gig was with an artist named Brad Martin, and he was on Sony at the time. So I played with him for about 2 years, and that gig led me to what really opened the door was with a guy named Tracy Byrd. Tracy Byrd he's in the realm of country music. He's one of the top kind of greats, I would call. He's still playing now, but as far as traditional country music, he did it. He did the Western Swing. He had a lot of big hits in the 90s. So I stayed with him about 4 years, and that really led me to other things. You know, once you get like an artist gig of that caliber, you know, people start to kind of go, oh, he plays with him. And, you know, in Nashville, that's kind of a badge of honor, and it helps you get other gigs. So, you know, I move on from him to having a record deal. I had a band that called Stone that had a record deal on Sony, and we recorded a record, and it was a really good band. I mean, it was a four-piece band. I had a guy that I grew up with playing drums named Derek Mixon. He and I were kind of like the pair, you know. You got your drummer that you grew up with, you got a drummer that you know, and you don't even have to talk, you just do it. He was the guy. So we've been playing together since we were 15. So it was with him and a guy named Dan Cohen, and all these guys I still play with. We still do a lot of recording together. But we had a record deal, started making a record, and about 2 weeks after we recorded the record, we got dropped from the label. And that's a very common thing. What happens is, I tell people it's not hard to get a record deal. It's just hard to keep one, right? So what happened was they had a lot of people that they fired at the label and basically cleaned house. And all the newer artists, they just canned them. And, you know, the newer guard that comes in, they want to bring their artists on. Sure. So from there, it just I started playing with other artists on and off, doing little one-offs. And I got a call from Steve Warner. And that to me was like a moment of, oh my gosh, I get a call from one of my heroes growing up. I mean, Steve Warner, if you don't know who he is, you need to check him out. Steve Warner is a legend. He, if you know guitarists, you know Chet Atkins. Is like, he's regarded as one of the top guitarist arrangers, part of Nashville. There are, I believe, 4 certified guitar pickers, and that's what Chet Atkins deemed as, you know, these guys are the ones that can do it. So it's Chet Atkins, and it was Jerry Reed, okay, Tommy Emmanuel, okay, and Steve Warner. Okay. So I got a gig with one of the CGP, Certified Guitar Pickers. So I played with him for a little over a year, I think. And then I get a call from someone with Luke Bryan organization. And at the time, you know, things happen. You know, you're looking for work, you're looking for gigs. My wife and I, we were having our second child. And, you know, the finances were getting a little low. And with Steve, you played a lot of smaller gigs. Like, you do, like, the Grand Ole Opry once a month. And one-offs here and there. Steve didn't do a whole lot of touring because he was over it. He'd done a lot of touring back in his youth, so now he was enjoying being a songwriter and playing when he wanted to. So needless to say, I was kind of needing a little more money. So somebody's getting some drinks over there. Yeah. So we are at a gig, so we're, you know, strange to have some quiet time. But I got the call for Luke Bryan, and
that was about when?
That was in 2010. Okay. Actually, it was December 2009, January 2010 is when I started. And at the time, Luke wasn't as big as he is now, obviously. He had
because he didn't have the right bass player at the
right,
time.
I didn't have the right bass player. But I came along just as his first number one single was starting, which was Do I. And that was a big, big hit.
Did you?
Yep. Do I did. I sure did. But, you know, we played, got back on the bus, and we were playing all the honky-tonks and bars and festivals and doing opening slots for other artists. So
I want to jump in for a minute because you mentioned the honky-tonks and the bars. When you were talking about Nashville, when you first went there, I think of those couple blocks on Broadway, which I kind of liken to the French Quarter in New Orleans, or maybe even Soho in London. Is that what you started out doing, playing in one of those bands that's, you know, in the window or upstairs or till 4 a.m. or whatever? Is that how you get started?
Absolutely. No, I did do that. I neglected to say that, but that's kind of like what you kind of have to do. You move the town, and I can't tell you how many free gigs I've played, how many crazy gigs that I played that I don't want to even remember. But you'd go and sit in, you'd meet people. It's like anything in life. You get to know people and you network. And the thing about Nashville that I love is people really look after each other. Now,
that's what everybody says.
It's people want to help other people. Now, I'm not saying, you know, people want a gig and they'd like to see their friends get a gig, or, you know, would rather have the gig over someone, you know, over you, you know. I'd like to work, get a gig first, you know. But at the same time, that's how I got my first gig, was a friend of mine named Rich Redman, who is a well-known drummer in Nashville and all over. He's been playing with Jason Aldean. He does a lot of recording. A great guy. He told me about the Brad Martin deal. He said, "Hey man, get your guys together and do this audition." He was playing with Aldean, or actually another band at the time, but he couldn't do it. So he said, "Man, get your guys together and do it." And that's how we got the gig. So I owe that to him telling me about it. Otherwise, I never would have known about it. And who knows, my career, my path might have been completely different from that one thing. You never know. But, you know, I did do a lot of gigs downtown. A lot of sit-ins, a lot of songs I've never – I mean, I can't even tell you how many – I mean, hundreds, maybe thousands of songs that I played once or twice, and I don't even – don't know where it goes, you know.
You know how to read the music notation that they use only in Nashville and nowhere else?
Yeah, man, that is amazing. And I think that needs to be taught all over, because it's so logical. Like, it takes so much time away from having to arrange things, you know. And music notation's great. You know, I'd love for people to always be able to read that first. But only one time in Nashville in my 18 years I've ever been given an actual chart of music.
Did you remember how to read it?
Oh yeah. I still read, you know. But it's so efficient. And me having my studio and doing a lot of leading a lot of sessions and stuff, it's very practical. And I write charts pretty much. If I don't do it every other day, I'm doing it, you know, 3 or 4 times a week.
Well, you write them the Nashville way.
Yeah, I write them the Nashville way. Okay. I've had people pay me to do charts, you know, but most people who are working, they can do charts themselves. And there's it's something that I like to teach in our clinics that Kent and I do is a little section where we have a chart that I wrote, and then Kent has a chart that he would have written as a drummer.
I'm sorry, Kent?
Kent Slusher is our drummer with Luke Bryan. And he and I do a lot of clinics together. We call ourselves the Foundation. Ah. So it's a pretty fun clinic situation where
we not go, to be confused with the Section.
No, not the Section, but yeah. But we'll do two separate charts, and he writes his basically in stick figures. You know, he's a drummer. He doesn't have to have the changes and the harmony. So we'll show his, and then we'll show mine, and I'll show why it's so logical to do it. You can change keys. That's the beauty of it. You know, you can... You take a chart, this is the song, pick your key. Doesn't matter what key you're doing it in, it's still doesn't change.
Sounds like Roman numerals or something. I wonder why that hasn't caught on
exactly
in New York or LA. Tell me a little bit about the current gig and about the Luke Bryan tour and whatever else you'd want to share with us briefly.
Well, I will say that when I get on stage and I play in somewhere like this in Ford Field, I'm just in awe of my gosh, you know, we're playing in front of, you know, 50,000 people.
Well, I thought you were in awe because this is where the Detroit Lions. Did I mention that we're in a place where the Detroit Lions play?
Yeah, Detroit Lions.
But I think last time anybody counted, there were like 80,000 seats, and that's when they play football. So there's probably a lot of seats on the main floor on the field as well.
I really don't know the numbers, but I do know Luke said earlier that it is completely sold out. So it is our last show of the tour, so it is pretty cool to have it sold out like this. But you know, life on the road with Luke and the guys is fun and it's relaxed. You know, we get to see really neat places all over the country, and we've gone to Australia, gone to Hawaii, been over to Europe once. I don't think Luke wants to go back. It was a pretty interesting experience, not because of Europe, but just because of the travel. You know, it's got to be. Traveling can be very, very, very stressful and tiring.
We'll do a follow-up interview, and I want to ask you about Europe because I have a feeling there's more to that story. But let's continue along the lines that you were going on.
Well, you know, the life of touring is you know, it depends on who you're with and what you're doing. I mean, I've been in the van and trailer, you know, schlepping gear, loading it up late at night, and taking turns driving and getting home and wondering how you got home. Like, oh, my gosh, that's so dangerous. You know, and then coming to this where you get off stage and go eat a piece of pizza and watch TV, watch Western and go to bed. You know, it's really an amazing thing to get to do. And I don't take it for granted because you do at times, you know, think about if you don't have a proper shower or you don't have, you know, where's catering? Oh, we got to walk this far for catering. Silly things like that, that we go, man, you know, just like anything, any other job, you sometimes we'll start to complain about things, and then you pinch yourself and go, oh, wait a minute. I don't have to go and sit on a roof down in Louisiana at 104 degrees and put a roof on, you know. So, you know, I my job is to be on stage for an hour and a half and entertain people, play my bass guitar. I mean, it's an amazing thing to get to do.
I just interviewed Blasco before the Ozzy Osbourne show, and he was telling me when he was 16 and traveling, and this is before email and texting, and he had no way of letting his parents know he was okay.
Yeah.
In dangerous situations, sleeping on floors. And that reminded me of when I was, it was back in the 80s, and I was in Miami. I got very involved in the Latin music scene. Uh-huh. And we're going to Colombia and Peru and all through Central America and South America. And it was not a safe time. Looking back on it, I feel very fortunate to have survived, not knowing how being too stupid to realize what I was in the middle of. So happy to be here, folks.
Yeah,
say, tell me briefly a little bit about your gear.
Well, my basses, I have quite a few basses I've accumulated over the past few years. And with this gig with Luke, I pretty much need to have a 5-string because a lot of the music that's being recorded currently has a lot of that material that's, you know, your low D's and some of your B's and stuff like that. So I've been playing a PRS Gary Granger bass. Wow. It's an amazing bass.
I interviewed him right when that bass came out at the PRS booth at the NAMM show.
How cool would it to have a bass named after yourself, you know? So, and a good bass like that. So I have a 4-string. I have your Fenders, you know, your normal Fenders. I've got a Jazz. Just got it this year. It's the what's it called? The original. The American Original series, isn't that right? American Original. It's the ones where they were doing, like it's a 60s jazz, a 70s jazz, P bass, so forth. Everything about it is exactly the way it was when it was made. Yeah, it's pretty cool. I have a 60s version of it,
okay.
And I play that quite a bit. And I also have a Roscoe. Keith Roscoe bass. I've got a few.
Just talked to Keith yesterday.
Yeah, he makes some amazing basses too. He's been really good to me over the years. I have this one bass that it's kind of like a PJ, and you know, a lot of their basses are just really beautiful, crafted, like works of art kind of. And the guy that they had there for a while, Guard, I told him that, you know, country guys, he wanted to get in the country market. I'm like, you know, a lot of the country guys, a lot of it is visual. for some reason, people, they get this thing about if you come up with a 5-string bass or a 6-string bass, that you're going to play too much. You know, because country music is about groove and feel, like everything. Yeah. It's really no different than anything else. But these guys sometimes will have this chip on their shoulder where this guy showed up with a 6-string bass and he started to play solos all over the place when he needs to be going boom, 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 right? So back to that story about Roscoe, I told him that you need to make something a little subdued, so to speak. Maybe more traditional, like a Fender, you know, because like a Sadowski, things of that nature. And they made one. It's been one of my favorite basses, and I'll show it to you later. It's just a generic looking, in a sense, but not really generic. I don't mean to downplay the bass, but
not generic sounding.
No, not generic sounding. It's like a PJ on steroids. So
what about amps and strings and things?
Well, I've been playing D'Addario strings for a long time. Love them. Planet Waves, you know, the cables and the straps. They've been really good to me. Picks, a lot of picks that I throw out all the time. I play Orange amps. I've got the flagship AD200, the big tube, 66 pounds, I think it is. I mean, it's massive, and it's a massive wall of sound. That with the 810 cabinet kind of laying on its side in front of the drum riser. It's pretty awesome. Puts out a lot of meat on stage. So
810 cabinet will do that.
And the good thing, the beauty of it is I don't have to carry it.
Yeah.
I don't have to do anything. my crew guys get all that for me. So
you're a rock star.
I don't know about that. I'm a country music star.
Okay.
No. You know, this is, you say that, what we do is pretty much equivalent to the 80s arena rock. Mm-hmm. Like Def Leppard and Poison and all that.
Where's the spandex and the hair extension?
I'm the only one with the hair, that's for sure. Spandex, I don't know, but yeah, it's 80s arena rock without the makeup and lipstick. So,
Well, I have one last question for you, James. There's so much more we can talk about. Like I mentioned, we'll do a follow-up interview. I want to hear about Europe and some other stuff. Yeah. But in the meantime, what would you be if you weren't a bass player? Something outside of music.
Ooh, that's a good question. I mean, I always, a buddy of mine back in the day, we both wanted to play and be pilots. So my buddy chose to be a pilot, and I chose to be a musician or a bass player. So I don't know if I'd be a pilot, but probably, most likely, I'd be a chef. Okay. As my name suggests, cook. I love to cook.
There you go.
I love to eat, too, but cooking is just, it makes me so happy. So I'd probably go into the culinary arts. But I don't know. I do a little bit of everything. I'm a woodworker. I love to work with wood. And I don't know. It's a good question.
Do you know Steve Morse? Dixie Dregs and Deep Purple. I believe he is a pilot.
Oh, I think I've heard that, actually. Yeah, so a lot. It's kind of an artsy thing, too. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go get my pilot's license one day.
Well, there you go. We have so much more to talk about. But we'll leave it at that for now. It's so great to sit down with you and meet you in person. We've spoken on the phone, which is always fun. But good luck with the rest of the tour, which is only one more show. And keep doing what you're doing, and we'll keep enjoying it.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, congratulations on all your success. Keep it coming.
Thank you, John. I appreciate it.
I'm on location at Ford Field. Did I mention this is the home of the Detroit Lions?
You might have said that a time.
Yes. Before the Luke Bryan Show with Luke Bryan bassist James Cook, I'm John Liebman. You're watching for BassPlayersOnly.com.